That again. Welcome to week six of our series we call Say What. So yeah, if you can't say six right, you're in trouble, right? And so this has been. Have you enjoyed this series? I've enjoyed preparing for it and teaching you the series. I've had a lot of fun. I think it's helped us with a lot of things. And really, it's about the idea that there's spiritual beliefs that we have that are, we think are biblical, we think they're right, but they actually don't line up with Scripture. And so then life, when it, life slaps us in the face and it doesn't go the way we thought the Bible said it should go, then who do we doubt? We doubt God. And we often tend to shipwreck our faith or walk away from our faith. And so today is also another, besides this message and the service today, we're also going to celebrate our graduates. And we've got some awesome graduates today. And some of you that are, you know, that are, you're graduating and you can't wait. You're like, I cannot wait to be 18. Maybe some of you out of the house. I can do what I want. I've been waiting. I've been having people tell me what to do my whole life, and I just can't wait. And you know, it sounds so freeing. But the reality is the transition from high school to college to working adult can be one of the most minefield type situations you'll ever face in your life, because the reality is many people end up losing their faith and walking away from God in those 4 or 5 years. And I think it has a lot to do with what we're talking about today, and that is the idea that when we go off to college or when we go do these, you know, we kind of go into adulthood, all of a sudden we're exposed to a new set of people. And there's nothing intrinsically wrong with that unless we're not ready for it. Okay? And so we get around different people with different standards of right and wrong, and if we don't actually have a biblical worldview, which is a whole nother thing we won't get into today. But if you don't really understand, you think, well, I'm a good moral person and I got to, you know, if you don't really know why you believe what you believe, you're going to be in trouble when you get with those who know why they believe what they believe and it doesn't line up with the Word of God. But tied into that is also, we often don't have a proper understanding of our conscience. We don't know what our conscience is supposed to do. And so we get in our heads, you know, just go with our conscience. You know, after all, in the movie Pinocchio, Jiminy Cricket said, or there was told, you know, always let your conscience be your guide. And some of us as kids, we watched that 100 times or whatever. And so we just got wired into us. And so we're gonna follow our conscience. So let's back up a little bit. What is our conscience? According to the Oxford Dictionary, it's an inner feeling or a voice viewed as acting as a guide to the rightness or wrongness of one's behavior. That sounds like a good thing. Doesn't it have a conscience to tell you what's right or wrong? But is it? Here's the thing. Regardless of our age, our life experience, the question is, should we let our conscience be our guide? Proverbs 14:12 says, there is a path before each person that seems right, but it ends in death. You thought you were doing the right thing. Your conscience didn't go off. No warning bells were sounded. You thought that you did the right thing, but it ends in death. And I want to just tell you, that ain't good. I mean, that's scary. I mean, you know, all of us can look at our lives and say, I think I'm doing the right thing, but man, what if it ends in death? What if it ends in the wrong thing? You know, the Apostle Paul, and by the way, many of you know who the Apostle Paul is, but he was this amazing church planter. He planted a lot of churches. He was this amazing man of God. God used him mightily, but you know what else? Paul did not trust his conscience. You know, he'd launch these churches, and then he'd have to write letters to fix everything that was wrong in the church. That's what you call the New Testament. There's about 12, 13 books, something like that, in the New Testament written by the Apostle Paul to various of those churches to get things straightened out, right? And he even made mistakes on his mission trips. Remember that young man, a missions intern, you know, John Mark? And so he was out there, and he decided he'd had enough. It was too hard. He was tired of sleeping on the ground, and he was tired of the persecution, all of this. He just walked away. And so the next mission trip came up, and Paul said, I ain't going with him. And many think he was the one that ended up writing the book of Mark in the New Testament. God redeemed it, but Paul got it wrong on that one. We make mistakes. So knowing we thinking we're doing the right thing may not actually be the right thing. Paul said this in 1 Corinthians 4:3-4, as for me, it matters very little how I might be evaluated by you, whoo, pray for me, or by any human authority. He said, I don't even trust my own judgment on this point. Verse 4, my conscience is clear, but that doesn't prove I'm right. It is the Lord himself who will examine me and decide. Paul's saying here, just because you have a clear conscience, just because I have a clear conscience, does not mean we were right. It does not mean that we did the right thing. And because really what matters is what? What God says. Amen. That's what matters. So I'm going to kind of spoiler alert right here at the beginning. The reality is that our conscience should not be trusted, should not be our guide. And let me give you some reasons why. There's out there floating out there this trustworthy conscience myth. You can just always trust your conscience. Well, here's some problems with it. One, your conscience confuses certainty with godliness. Have you ever talked with someone who was absolutely convinced they were morally right? And when you pulled out 500 scriptures or five, there was no convincing them that they were, their certainty of their conscience overrid their desire for godliness. We see it all the time. It feels good. It's got to be right. Not so fast. Psalm 14:1 says, only fools say in their hearts there is no God. They are corrupt and their actions are evil. Not one of them does good, right? If we have this corrupted mindset, if you will. So the interesting thing about this verse is that the word fool here does not mean ignorant or unlearned. It's the Hebrew word nabal, and it means a person who has no perception of ethical or religious truth. They don't get it. Amen. What your conscience does not forbid can hurt you. Right. It can cause problems. Secondly, our conscience cannot be trusted because our conscience gives competing guidance. Yeah. You ever experienced this? So depending on your past, you have at least three sets of guidance going on in your conscience. If you were not saved, did not give your life to the Lord, you had to be exposed to the things of the Bible till later on in life, adulthood maybe, you have your pre-Christian values. That was where your conscience was at, things you would do or things you would have done before you came to Christ without a second thought. You would have never even done any different. You just thought that's the way it was. And, it's not really probably good to list some things, but it's like cursing or premarital sex or drunkenness or all these. We'd have just done it because that's what everybody else was doing. That was our conscience. That was our standard. And then maybe some of you came to Christ early, but you came to Christ in a legalistic church. Yeah, amen. All right. And in that church, I was raised with a church that had some legalism. Even into adulthood, I felt guilty playing Uno because cards were the devil. Yeah. And only gamblers played with cards. Right? So we got that thing going on in our head. Some of us got that going on in our head. Or maybe you came out of a past where how you dressed was more important than whether you gossiped or not. Just slide your toes underneath the chair there for a minute. I'm not quite done. Amen? All right. I'll stop there. Right? So we got that set of voice. We got the legalistic voice in the head. And then hopefully all of us have a third voice in our head, and that's the competing voice of biblical values. Amen. What God's standards are, what God wants. And so knowing which one is which at which time can be difficult. Which one's speaking to me? Is this my legalism? Is this my pre-Christian? Is this biblical values? And then it all gets mushed together and really can't be trusted. So thirdly, your conscience cannot be trusted because your conscience and mind is affected by our sin nature. Right? When we give when we repent and we give our lives to Jesus, the Bible says we're made right with God. What does that mean? There's a word for that called justified. You probably heard this, just as if I'd never sinned. So when God looks at you, he sees you that way. He sees you as righteous and right standing with him because you simply surrendered your life to Jesus and made him Lord of your life. But finding freedom from past thoughts, past habits, past behaviors, and even current ones is a lifelong process that we call sanctification. You got to get them right here. Sanctification. You're set apart, but you're walking into that process of being fully sanctified in Christ. And so our sin nature is always trying to pull us back towards things that displease God and would destroy our lives. It's always out there. And so spiritually, you may not understand this, but spiritually, your flesh, what your natural desires are, your sin nature, its power is actually defeated when you give your life to Jesus. Because just like Trina was saying in the worship, he has all authority.
Amen.
But your flesh don't act like it.
Amen.
And then you get your conscience involved and you end up not agreeing with God, right? So the voice of sin is actually very easily confused with our conscience. In fact, sin influences our conscience. Which is why we need a small group every semester.
Amen.
You just need to be in a place where some people are talking about God, talking about Scripture, are leaning into learning some things, a place to connect with others, a place to learn what God's saying, a place to receive prayer. Come on, how many know we need that?
Amen.
We need encouragement. We need somebody to say, hey, I'm praying for you. I'm believing with you. We're going to stand in this together. A place to grow, like I said, in the knowledge of Scripture. So I'm just going to say it again. If you haven't signed up for a small group, now's your time. Now's your time. Go to our webpage, sign up. Do that. Do that today. And I just say everyone needs a group. You say, well, I don't need a group. You don't need a group until you need a group.
Right.
And then it's too late. You don't have the relationships. You don't have the people to stand with you. And then, slide your toes back quick. And then you say, well, that church just let me down.
Yeah.
Well, nobody knew you. Moving along.
That's good for you.
I'm just moving along. Right?
Yeah.
You got small groups is a place to be known.
Yeah, that's right.
For someone to know you and you to know somebody else. So fourth, your conscience can't be trusted because it can become, and this is a big one. Your conscience can become calloused.
Amen.
This is really big. So we're going to look at this in two groups. First of all, for unbelievers. For those without Christ, Romans 1:18 says, but God shows his anger from heaven against all sinful, wicked people who suppress the truth by their wickedness. So how does sinfulness suppress truth? One way is it sears our conscience and we begin to create a society where certain behaviors are tolerated that are against God's standards. And let's face it, we've all been affected by our pre-Christian life. Even if you say, I came to the Lord at 7, I'm affected by things that I heard in those formidable years, right? In those formation years. So what's the result, though, if we keep living in that worldly conscience, that societal conscience? Verse 24, so God abandoned them to do whatever shameful things their heart desired. As a result, they did vile and degrading things with each other's bodies. Verse 26, that is why God abandoned them to their shameful desires. Even the women turned against the natural way to have sex and instead indulged in sex with each other. And the men, instead of having normal sexual relations with women, burned with lust for each other. Men did shameful things with other men, and as a result of this sin, they suffered within themselves the penalty they deserved. Since they thought it foolish to acknowledge God, that's where it starts, right? He abandoned them to their foolish thinking and let them do things that should never be done. Verse 29, their lives became full of every kind of wickedness, sin, greed, hate, envy, murder, quarreling, deception, malicious behavior, and
gossip.
All of these behaviors are ungodly. We like to pick the ones we want to choose out of this, you know, pick them out, but they're all in God. They are backstabbers, haters of God, insolent, proud, and boastful. They invent new ways of sinning and they disobey their parents. Come, you know, he's just riding away, you know, like, man, I agree, that's a sin. Then he goes right to disobey your parents. Come on, kids. Got something for all of us to be working on, right? 31, they refuse to understand, break their promise, are heartless, and have no mercy. Yikes. Does it look anything like society?
Hmm?
They know God's justice requires that those who do these things deserve to die, yet they do them anyway. Worse yet, they encourage others to do them too. This is not the path that God wants for any of us. This is not his intent. This is not his heart. But the natural result of not acknowledging God and just staying on that course and letting your conscience be seared ends up at this place. It's inevitable. That's why, let's just be honest, that's why racism flourishes in families. Because there's this family, whether they know God or we'll get to the believers in just a minute, but there's just these things that are transferred down in families. All these kinds of things, and it's because of the conscience. And so the conscience of the kids are seared, are callous, because they see the way mom and dad act, and so they just think that's the right way to do it. Right? Come on. You're not amening me, but I'm preaching good here. That's why we cannot depend on our conscience. The same challenge, though, exists for those of us who are believers. In Titus, the Apostle Paul's writing to the church there, and he's writing to Titus, who was the pastor, the leader, and he says, everything is pure to those whose hearts are pure, but nothing is pure to those who are corrupt and unbelieving, because their minds and consciences are corrupted. Hold on, time out here. Did he just say to believers, those that are unbelieving? He did. Because their minds and consciences are corrupted. Such people claim they know God, but they deny him by the way they live. Amen. They are detestable and disobedient, worthless for doing anything good. Now, I wouldn't have written it that way, but that's why nothing I write's in the Bible. But that's pretty strong. That's a warning for us as believers that we've got to be careful that we don't allow our conscience to be corrupted. That we watch what we put in our thoughts and our minds. We've got to be careful. So whether you're a believer or an unbeliever, the conscience can be callous. It can be seared. Amen. So you got to understand, as a Christian, you can be desensitized to doing wrong as well. Amen. Say, well, I'm not sure. We're going to get real practical here. Some of you, probably most of you, have been exposed to porn. The very first time you were exposed to porn, it was probably you were ashamed and you felt shame. But it was also very exciting. So you went back again and you went back again. And before long, it was just part of normal life. People would look and say, well, everybody does it. The societal norm would be everybody's doing it. Everybody's doing it. What happened? Your conscience got seared. It got calloused. Didn't feel like a big deal anymore. Maybe it was the same way with premarital sex. It's like the first time, that was good. Continued. Conscience calloused. So we become desensitized to sin. And so with that as a background, let's think about how do most of us use our conscience? How do we operate on our conscience? What we tend to treat our conscience as a God-given indicator of right and wrong. That's how we tend to look at it. When we face a tough moral dilemma, we turn to our conscience. And if we have peace, then we assume it's okay. But the problem with peace as a guidance system is that often what we take as God's concurrence with our decision is really the absence of guilt. I don't feel guilty doing that, so I have peace. But the reason we don't feel guilty is because our conscience has been seared and it's been calloused, and there's no longer any red flags going off when we do that. Amen. Right? After a couple times, the guilt goes away. Oh, he's like, oh, good news. It's only when it would go away. The guilt may go away, but the consequences will catch up with you. Amen. You can't win. So what's the problem? So the problem was we thought, and us thinking that our conscience is some sort of spiritual thermometer. We think our conscience will tell us when it's too hot or it's too cold. It's right or it's wrong. So let's get a clear understanding of what the conscience is and why we have one. So I call it conscience clarity. Here's the first thought. Our conscience is not a spiritual thermometer. Our conscience is actually a spiritual thermostat. Big difference. Thermostats don't define hot or cold. People do. They reflect our definitions of hot and cold. I've had a wife who is pregnant. I have a daughter who's pregnant. I have a daughter-in-law who's pregnant. All of them are, not Kim, but the other two are expecting babies. One of them any day now. And if you've ever lived in a home with a pregnant woman, you know that the definitions of hot and cold vary widely. I mean, hot for a pregnant woman might be 60 degrees. Hot for a man might be 75, and hence the conflict begins. And the same thing is true in our conscience. The definitions vary, right? The definition of comfortable for each person is different with hot and cold, and the same thing can be true in our conscience. See, you see, our conscience is not automatically set to God's standards. Our conscience is set to our standards. Does that sound right? So think about it. At birth, our conscience is innocent, but as we experience life and are exposed to harmful things, it adjusts. What's right, what's wrong? Pastor Larry Osborne says this, our conscience does not tell us if we are violating God's standards. It tells us when we violate our standards. Parents, I want to just talk to you for a minute. That's why you got to know what your kids are watching, and you get to decide. Because when you let them watch things, and I'm not against people. I love technology in the right hands. Amen. At the right ages. But when you have that phone, they can be influenced by everybody else's conscience and standard of values, not yours. And the same thing is true with any media you consume.
Amen.
So I want to just tell you, I'm the product of a family that only had a television 2 years out of the first 18 years, and we had no smartphones, by the way. They did not exist. No computer in the house. Some of your parents are like, oh, glory. That would be amazing. In fact, we got a TV for 2 years, and we'd never, grandma had one. I'd go watch my sports team, watch football on Sunday after church. She'd let me come over and spend time watching a little football. But other than that, no TV. So when I got into adulthood, even in high school, I thought I missed out. I want to tell you, as an adult, I missed out on nothing.
Amen.
I missed out on nothing.
Amen.
I missed out on nothing. In fact, it kept me for a lot of things. It's a blessing. So kids, parents, when your kids fight and fuss and scream, just look them in the eye and say, I love you. Let me have that. Let me see where you've been. Say, it's my phone. No, it's not. Who's paying the bill?
Amen.
Are we all twisted up? It ain't your phone. I'm paying the bill. You get out, you go get your own job. And then watch what your conscience lets you do.
Amen.
So what's the value of a conscience? I better move along because I see people. Our conscience is an early warning system. Our conscience can be a great yellow light. It can be a great red light to stop us from stupidity and sin.
Amen.
We won't go into my stupidity. I've done things. But you know that little twinge of ugh, I don't know if I should do this. That'll keep you from some stuff, and that's a good thing, right? But it's important to remember that our conscience is a terrible, I wouldn't say terrible,
terrible.
Green light.
Amen.
It's a terrible green light. Do not rely on your conscience to give you permission. It's going to be wrong. Depending on your life and what you expose your conscience to. So that's why who you pick as friends is very important, because they're going to be speaking into your life. They're going to help set the norm for you. Again, that's why you need a small group, right? And otherwise, we're just a few simple decisions from ruining our lives and maybe the lives of a lot of other people. Here's what 1 Timothy 4:1 says. Now, the Holy Spirit tells us clearly that in the last times, are we living in the last times? Oh, yeah. If you didn't know, we are. So how long will it last? Well, that I don't know. But we've been in them for a while. Some will turn away from the true faith. So these are Christians who turn away from the faith. They will follow deceptive spirits and teachings that come from demons. I see it all the time. It's happening. Verse 2, these people are hypocrites and liars. I love how the Bible doesn't mince words. And look at the third thing. And their consciences are dead. People who call themselves Christians can become so calloused that in fact their conscience is dead. No value. Not contributing anything to their spiritual walk. It can get to that point. So if the guiding principles in God's word are quite different from your conscience, then it's time to do something different. It's time to do something, and I'm going to call it today realigning our conscience. We got to get our conscience where it's a better guide, right? Well, I won't get ahead of myself. Here's the first thing. How do we do that? First of all, we got to recognize, repent, and reject ungodly standards in our own lives and our own conscience. How do we recognize when our conscience is different from the standards of the Bible? Well, we go to church. Turn to somebody and say, you're doing good today. If you're listening to Pastor, I don't know where your thought life is right now, but come on, focus in here. If you're part of a small group, now that was the thing. We read His Word daily. How do you know what God's standard are? You get in the Word, especially the New Testament. If you're just starting out, I love the stories of the Old Testament, but if you're just starting out in your Bible reading, read the New Testament. Amen. Start reading Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the Gospels, especially the book of John. Read there about how much God loves you and God's love, and you just start taking that journey. Psalm 119:9 says, how can a young person stay pure? By obeying your Word. But it's very difficult to obey what you don't know. One of the best things that was done to me as a child was I was put in situations where I had to memorize lots of scripture. I was on a Bible quiz team. We'd take a whole book one year, every year, and they'd ask us hundreds of questions on them. And you'd sit on these chairs with buzzers on them. And if you knew the answer, the first one off the chair, well, it was competitive and it was Jesus. I was all in. This was great. Well, it's fantastic, right? And then I went to school and church. We had memory verses. Man, it's one of the best things you can do. It doesn't have to be a church program. Just start putting verses in your kids and have them memorize verses every week. Amen. Before they don't think they shouldn't. Right. Amen. Maybe it'll start as harder to start at 16 than it would be at 3. Get the word in them. Amen. So when we're in the Word, what happens is we can recognize the gaps. God says to go this way, but I'm over here. Something has to happen. So the first thing I do is I recognize it. Then I repent of it. Father, forgive me for thinking that I'm supposed to hate my enemies. I just read in your Word where you said to love your enemies and do good to those that hate you. Isn't that counterculture? Yeah. And isn't it hard? So you repent of that, but then you've got to move to rejecting it. And so when it comes up, man, I don't want to love them. No. I'm going to make a decision here. I'm going to do it God's way because I'm going to realign my conscience by making a decision that says I'm going to align with God's word instead of what I feel like or what it looks like or what the world says I should do. Amen. Amen? So you just ask God every time you reckon, oh, Father, forgive me. Help me. Give me strength. Amen? You got to make that decision. So just like the callousing of our conscience is a gradual thing downward, so the realigning of our conscience is a gradual process upward. Amen. It's not going to happen overnight. You just got to lean into it. So recognize, repent, and reject God, and reject ungodly standards. And so that's an ongoing process. And then number two, it's really what that process is called is renewing your mind. Renewing your mind. Romans 12:2 says, don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, But let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect. So it's difficult. It's more difficult to make right decisions. Young people, listen to me. It's more difficult to make right decisions when you don't have a transformed mind. So you've got to be transforming your mind. It says then you'll know the will. Sometimes I don't know what God wants me to do. Keep renewing your mind. You'll know. It'll become clear. Amen. So how do we not copy the behaviors and standards, customs of society? Keep filling your mind. What does the word say about that? Say, I don't know. Go find out. Talk to a leader. Talk to a small group leader. They'll help you find it out. Amen? So the more your conscience is set by God's word, the more likely it will keep you from things that displease God. So what if your conscience is the yellow light or the red light? The green light is the word of God. That's where you got to get to. Amen? So, and since all we're, you know, every one of us every day are probably exposed to things that begin to callous and degrade our conscience. So here's the third thing we should do. We've got to rinse off contamination daily. Rinse off contamination. Interesting verse here. In Ephesians 5, 25 through 27, this is usually read at weddings. It talks about husbands and wives. But in the middle of this, there's this gold. And Paul's writing here by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit about how Jesus is looking at the body of Christ, his church. It says he, Jesus, gave up his life for her, the church, that's us, to make her holy and clean, washed by the cleansing of God's word. God's word will cleanse. You've got problems.